21 years after the filming of the movie Stand By Me, in preparation for the Brownsville Rolling Roadshow, we interviewed a number of Brownsvillians who had participated in or watched the original production.
When the night has come and the land is dark and the moon is the only light we'll see, no, I won't be afraid. Oh, I won't be afraid. Just as long as you stand by me. So darling, darling, stand by me. Oh, stand by me. Oh, stand by me. Stand by me. If the sky that we look upon should tumble and fall, or the mountain should crumble to the sea, I won't cry, I won't cry. No, I won't shed a tear, just as long.
My name is Fran Wepler, live here in Brownsville, been here for about 30 years. Well, our families were asked if they wanted to participate in the pie eating contest scene, and you could just sign up for it. My husband and I and my little son Ted, he was 5 at the time, he's 29 now, signed up, and we were given instructions to be down at the park at a certain time, and we all went down and they handed out bags to each person in the that was going to be in the barf scene. Didn't tell us much about it, but just said, here's a bag, and it had a 1, 2, 3, 4, or 5 number on it. And then Rob Reiner came out and he said, okay, we're gonna do this barf scene, and when I call your number, then I want you to throw up on the person next to you, or you know, really make it ham it up. Well, I had a number 5, and every bag was filled with cottage cheese and blueberry pie filling. And so you had to hold it in your mouth, wipe off everything off your mouth, and you know, pretend like it wasn't in there. And then people started barfing, and they had actually had tubes behind a lot of the women in the auxiliaries, and they went down below, and somebody behind underneath was shooting these old water guns, and this barf would come out. And so I guess lard ass first, he barfs on the people on the pie eating contest, and then they start the ricochet movement, and I couldn't hold it till 5. I think I barfed on 3. But unfortunately, my husband and I were cut out because we were standing right next to the 2 twin boys that barf on each other. But our son Ted and a few of the neighborhood kids are sitting below the Shriners, and they got their barf scenes. And they said, if you'll barf on me, I'll barf on you. And so it was fun. And we all did the scene. Everybody thought it was great. We all went outside. Everybody had to wash off their shirts. And then he says, oh, let's do it again. And so everybody went in, and Rob Reiner wanted a second take. But it was pretty cool. It was fun. It was an experience. Remember, I held this thing in my mouth so long that instead of barfing on my husband, I think I just was so worried about not really barfing. Because when you see people throw up, you have a gag reflex, and you really do start to throw up. So I don't know what I did, but evidently it wasn't good enough to be in the movie. So it was a lot of fun. It was, they had this kid, young kid, all padded. It was a very hot day like it is today, and he was padded with, you know, they call him lard ass, but he was padded with all this padding, and he wanted to take off his padding. And so he did that in between, and then they had to get him back in that. So, but it was, I enjoyed the process. I did, it was, and they fed us. They fed us so well. They gave us $35 a day, and they fed us this royal lunch. They fed everybody that was in the scene. And 2 of the kids that were friends of ours, a funny story about their dad is when they were shooting in town, any of the scenes in town, they asked the people, please don't run your lawnmowers or your chainsaws or have cars go by. Could we please have it quiet on the set? So our friend lived up in the house that's right there where Diana Barron is now, the doctor is, and one of the kids walks up that hill at the end of the movie, and their house is shown. Well, he decided he was cutting his trees and trimming, and so they came up and they said, well, we'll give you, I don't know what it was, maybe $100 a day not to use a chainsaw when we're going, and we'll put your kids in the movie. And so the next day, he said, okay, well, that happened yesterday. Now what'll happen? They came right back up there. He says, we'll give you $200 a day not to use a chainsaw today. So he every day, I think he used his chainsaw until until they finished the movie. So he made a little money on that. On it. Which is funny. Oh, isn't it time to cut the trees?
Yeah. The filming starts.
Yeah, yeah. They were good. They were passing money out right and left. But they made the... They had a scene here where this entire area, that wasn't a post office at the time, and it was an old gas station, and Rob Reiner stood in the middle of the street and they were shooting into the bar area, and the bar area was on a different, they had something else on, I think it was, well, it might have been pool or billiards on the window, and it's a scene where Kiefer Sutherland intimidates and harasses the two young boys, Will Wheaton and River Phoenix, and but we watched that scene being filmed as well. It was, and everything's shut down. The streets all stopped. Everybody stopped on the bridges. I watched the one when they were coming across the bridge. There were several scenes that they had up here. I didn't go up, but they had, you know, where the treehouse was. But the ones that were on the where they actually come around a block. They actually started it in one place, and if you know the town, you know they didn't come around that corner. And so they were at first behind where we have the Bella Cucina, and the, you know, they were back there, and then all of a sudden they come around this block and come and meet Kiefer Sutherland here. So we watched those, but they had to change places because I guess they liked the scene better. So. We met quite a few of the actors when we were watching them, but not as far as introductions. I did say hello to Rob Reiner. He's a very friendly guy, and boy, he made it just an easy situation for this town, and he was very polite and courteous, and we all knew him as Meathead from All in the Family. Kiefer Sutherland was, and Will Wheaton and River Phoenix were not, and even the other two boys. Corey Feldman was known for some television. Will Wheaton actually was in a TV show with my nephew, Scott Molini. They were in a spinoff from Little House on the Prairie called Father Murphy. So I knew of him. Kiefer Sutherland was not that big of an actor at the time, and none of them were. They were really just kind of young kids just breaking out. So I guess we weren't as impressed with it. Those other ones are starstruck, I should say. But I was more interested in Rob Reiner.
My name is Sheila Reidinger, and I've lived here most of my life since I was little. Grew up in Halsey, got married. Married a local boy, Andy Reidinger, and moved to Brownsville. Been here ever since. Don't think we're going anywhere. Our first baby was, oh, maybe 5 months old when Andy actually got to take, and I don't know his name, but he kind of showed some places to be able to film and stuff. So when he was out showing some different places around to film, there was the infamous pie eating contest. So Frankie, my mother-in-law, kept our baby, and it was an all-day shoot. I wish I now would have photographed that check. So it was we got $24 for the day, and it was just what a fun day. It out down in the park, and I got to kneel down with the kids in front of the were they elks? Were they? It was just the gentlemen, and so yeah, as they pulled off their hats and puked in those, and yeah, it was fun. It was the that was the best. Best part, but it was fun to the actors were kind of down there in the park, and it was real casual, and but yeah, people, and I've looked in the film, and I can't, you know, I think I'm in there somewhere, but no, it was a fun time, and what a great, and it was, like Linda said, it was just, our town came alive, and just to see all the activity, and to take us back in that time, and it was great.
I'm Jean Peterman. At the time the Stand By movie was being made, I lived up on Old Holly Road out of Sweet Home. My husband and I were starting on our vacation when I signed a card. Came back from vacation to get a telephone call, and Bob and I had a very exciting time during the tail end of my vacation and the starting of our work schedule again. It was just great fun. And experience that will just live in our memory for as long as we are around. And we're so excited about this particular situation of bringing Stand By Me back to Brownsville. I could tell you just exactly the color of sweats that Rob Reiner was wearing all through the shooting that led up to the great pie eat. And I personally have a real bone to pick with him, because I was filmed as one of the lodge ladies, or lodge men, excuse me, but the lodge men's wife, auxiliary lady, for at least 2 full days, dressed in wardrobe and my own little white pumps, and I was allowed to do my own hair and makeup. But it was pretty exciting, and then to find out that Rob Reiner said she looks much too young to be one of those auxiliary lodge people wife. And so that's where it ended up, with maybe just a spectator, but I was. And the greatest day came when Rob Reiner came dressed not in red sweats anymore, but in a white shirt for sure. And that was the day of the great pie eat. And that's when I fully realized that Stand By Me was a buffoon about a lot of things. Because we were given little bags of blueberries to put in our mouth as we sat there as spectators after the pie eating contest. And we were ready to bite into those blueberries and spit it on our neighbors. It sounds terrible, but we were game to do it. And I had my bag there ready to bite in my mouth. And all of a sudden, from the back of the tent came the most terrible blast of blueberries, gallons of blueberries. And there was Rob Reiner in his white outfit standing up there just laughing like crazy. And after it was all over and I got down off of the seat, which I can't find myself in that movie, but I know I was there covered with blueberries. And I got down off there and I chased Rob Reiner for quite a little ways, and he went screaming like a 16-year-old girl. And I didn't catch up with him, of course, because I don't think I would have had nerve enough to spit blueberries on the great director, Rob Reiner, let alone try to rub off that blueberries. And so I think that was probably the real climax, was Rob Reiner just had great fun making this movie.
My name is Bill Reidinger, and this is my wife, Frankie Reidinger. And my parents own the house down here, Ella and Clarence Reidinger. And the PR man came in and wanted to rent the house or use the house. And they offered them a certain amount of money, and Mother and Dad said, no, I don't think so. A couple of days later, he came back and offered them more money, and they said, no, I don't think so. And so the third time he came back, they said, I'll tell you what, we'll give you $2,500 and we'll paint your house. And my dad says, okay, we'll do that. So anyway, my dad loves food, and when they had the scene at the dinner table, they would fill the plates up with food, and maybe a couple of people would take a bite or two, and then they would stop the showing and take all the food into the kitchen, and they would empty it all out. And my dad thought that was such a waste. And then they'd fill the plates, and then they'd go back on another scene. And so at the end of the day, there was a pretty good-sized piece of roast left, and my dad says, well, what are you going to do with that? And they said, well, we'll probably have to throw it out. He said, well, I'll take it then. So anyway, they always had food outside, and my dad was always out there eating. And he really liked that. One of the scenes was when they brought in some topsoil and put a garden in between the house and the garage. And they use wilted plants like the corn and the tomatoes. And my father loves gardening, and he couldn't stand to see anything wilt. So as soon as they were done shooting, he got a hold of those plants and brought them back to life. The four young boys, when they were not in the film or shooting, they had time off, and we had a two-headed calf in the window, and they would come down and look at that two-headed calf. They spent lots of time looking at that calf.
And I think the one who played the main character, Jerry, I don't know, he came back last summer, I think, and with his wife and family and ate lunch at the cafe, and I think he looked for the two-headed calf, but it's gone now.
Yeah. So
they're around the dinner table, and the younger boy's remembering his big brother and how he was an athlete or something, and the father was more interested in him being an athlete than the younger boy being a writer. And he always kind of had his feelings hurt. So that was the scene. And then they did a scene looking out the window. And then the bedroom scene was some other house where the boy goes up in his now deceased brother's bedroom, I think it was. So you never know where it's filmed.
Hi, I'm Eric Gerber, and I live in the house that was the storyteller's house in the movie Stand By Me. And though I didn't live there at the time, we bought and moved into the house about 10 years after the movie was filmed. But I had seen the movie as a college student and thoroughly enjoyed it, and it was an added bonus to move into the house that was one of the houses in Stand By Me. I guess that my angle to be able to talk to you is that we have a lot of interesting tourists that come by and want to see our house and other Stand By Me locations. But I know it happens at our house. And a few times a year, there might be a car full or a van full of tourists that come to see the house and get a quick picture. And I guess one of the interesting things is predominantly they're of Asian descent, and even beyond that, mostly Japanese, not other Southeast Asian countries represented, but Japanese nationals that for one reason or another have a fascination with the movie Stand By Me. I guess it's kind of a cult classic there. And after a while I started asking more questions because it became interesting to me. Well, what made this movie such a classic? What's drawing these people over here to Brownsville to come check out the house that Stand By Me was filmed in, or one of the houses? And I've gotten varied answers. I don't know if I know the answer, or if there is one answer, but some of the things, one of the things I asked, well, what is it about it? And some of the answers that come back are like the music that was in the film, from Lollipop Lollipop to other music of that genre that was in the film. And it was kind of 50s music post-World War II. And it was, you know, probably some of the music that the GIs brought over that they heard there after the war. And, you know, in my mind, I think that's part of it. It's the fascination with American culture, and that's the time that they were being exposed more to American culture. And that's one of the things that draws them to this movie as opposed to some of the other movies.
I am Bill Nelson, and I was around a lot when the Stand By Me was filmed in Brownsville. And I remember in particular various shots, like in front of the tavern where they had a fight over a hat, and they did several retakes of that. And then in the rear was the Blue Point Diner, and it was before our present alley was built, so it was just rough ground back there. And it was interesting to watch that being filmed also. And the kids were real fun. They had a gun, and the gun went off and they all ran. And they shot each episode many times. And so we watched that. And then the main one that was the most fun was in the park down here, right over there. They had a white tent and they had the pie eating contest. And there were a lot of local people in the audience. And also they had little pumps behind their ears. When they threw up, somebody pressed the button and the vomit, the blackberry stuff, came out and shot quite a distance. And then for retakes, they had a garden hose out there and they washed people off and then they went back for the retake. And they did several of those. And that was fun to watch also. And then some of the traffic control kids were friends of ours, and they would have to stop the traffic whenever the shot was being taken. And some of the people in their cars would get upset and yell at the kids and so forth. Also, there were several merchants in town that claimed they lost business because of the restriction of the traffic. And so they were compensated for that. And plus, there was one fellow that wanted to mow his lawn that day. And so he was compensated for not mowing his lawn. And that was a good experience for him because he made money on that. But overall, it was just fun to watch them in the process of making the film. I noticed the director would sit off on a bench like during the pie eating contest and all by himself. And he didn't seem to be actually in the action or directed it. He just sat by the side and watched. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And then the end where the boys walked down the street to after they'd found the body and were coming home. And I watched that being filmed, and one of the boys stopped in the middle of Main Street and picked up a penny and said something about that's good luck. And then they went their separate way. Mm-hmm. But, we as owners of the health club were, all the signs were changed to the Women's Auxiliary Club, and they somehow dulled down the exterior of the building with some sort of dust-like paint, and then the windows, they put a film on them so they wouldn't reflect somehow back to the camera. So the buildings look pretty unkept. The other thing that I might add is that since the movie, we've had a lot of Japanese tourists, young people, who wanted to come to Brownsville and see the sights. And you could always spot them on Main Street with their camera. And I talked to a lot of them, and I gave them the map that my wife Joni made of the sights where the film was made. And I even took them around to some of the sites. And so that was fun too.
Okay, my name is Laura Lebo, and my sister and I went to audition for a part in the movie, Stand By Me. My sister actually got the part of being puked on the blueberry scene. my sister Lisa got to be puked on for the whole day, and she was not a happy camper after it was over with. And me, since I was turned down, I went to the Brownsville pharmacy, and as I was walking in, three young men approached me, and it turned out to be the three young men that are the main stars, and they were telling me they were stars and they wanted to show me a good time. And I said, I don't know who you are and I don't think you're a star. And it turned out later on that they were important, except for the one that later on passed away. And I don't know what happened. One of them became the Star Trek guy, and the other one, I'm not sure what happened to him.
My name is Andy Redinger. The only stories that I have for Stand By Me is my grandparents' house they used in the film. One of the, I would say, public relation guy, he had came over and was asking my folks about certain scenes that he was looking for. They had asked me. I took him Upper Kalapuya to some certain spots. He was looking for a tunneled area that would simulate walking down to the train tracks where they would be looking for the body. So we spent, I'd say, a good portion of the day driving around in these areas. I think there was one spot that we had stopped that they used in the film, and that was at the very last of the film, where Richard Dreyfuss was parked, and the camera looked across this field, and he was telling it the end of the story. And I believe that's the only part that was used in the film. One of the things I do remember going up and watching scenes up above Carlson's, where they had the treehouse. There was an era where people could stand and listen to watch the production of it, and I could hear the boys inside of the treehouse singing the songs that they did. Listen to Gordy talk. He's trying to tell the boys how he knows where a dead body is. So remembering that, I was pretty exciting to watch that portion of it. Other than that, I was downtown watching when they filmed the boys coming out of the tavern, and they stole the boys' New York hat. I was at that point, and I stood behind the camera and was right behind Rob Reiner.
Good evening. I'm Charlene Shipley. I was born and raised here. I'm fifth generation pioneer descendant that settled here in the Willamette Valley. Stand By Me was part of my childhood. It was an opportunity to really, oh wow, somebody else had the same experience that we did. There was about six or eight of us girls that we called ourselves our gang. And it was always when we were in junior high and grade school, we'd take our bicycles and we'd pack a lunch and we would decide which direction we'd go, to Shed, to Halsey, towards Sweet Home. We'd go swimming, of course, in the Kalapuya, in Crawfordsville and around. And we also got to go through some farmhouses, and we thought they were haunted houses, and we had all kinds of stories. So when Mr. Reimer had this wonderful idea for the Stand By Me, it was awesome. It was incredible. That's why some of the popularity, I think, has taken off, because there's, you know, we're number one America here, and I think everybody has had a childhood, has been on the tracks and on the trestle of that we're in Stand By Me, and had, we never found a body. We never had that kind of a mystery, but it was really, really fun. The community got together. my daughters were asked, they thought that would be a fun thing to do. So they were in the movie and I was like a stage mom, if you will, and was teased about it. But we had fun, and so our part in the movie happened to be in the Barforama, which was held here in the park. Behind me, we were in a huge white tent that encompassed most of this green area here, and was to simulate something like our pioneer picnic in a pie-eating contest. And we had a lot of fun with the blueberries and the cottage cheese that was in our little black plastic bags. That was what we were supposed to have been all eating and recycling the blueberries, if you will. And so behind the scenes was fun. The girls got to play Monopoly in between scenes with River Phoenix and all of, you know, the others. We had wonderful meals that were catered here. We had wardrobe, and I got to wear a dress from wardrobe. I had the shoes at home that fit the time. And it was one of the most memorable few weeks, you know, in filming that here.
My name is John Wagner, and I lived in Brownsville during the time of the filming of Stand By Me. One of the stories was the fact that I was on the Neighborhood Watch program when they were filming. And I'm not sure where the money came from, but the motion picture studio donated $500 to the Neighborhood Watch program if we'd watch their equipment at night. We did that for about 3 weeks, and you know, they paid and everything was fine. Another story I have is that I live next door to the house that they filmed at on Lynn Way. The scene where the kids were in the backyard around the old junk cars. Well, at the time, that place was owned by Jack Richardson. And at the time, they paid him $980 for one day's filming in the backyard of his place. Well, then there was a hedge between my place and that place, and at 5:30 in the morning, I got woke up to all this noise, and here's all this sound equipment being parked in my front yard. And nobody told me anything of what was going on, so finally Jack came over and says, here, this is what the deal is, and rig after rig parked and wedged in different places and stuff like that. And I went on to work, and when I came home, everything was gone. So one of the unusual stories was, it was during Pioneer Picnic, and shortly after Pioneer Picnic, they came in and changed all the fronts on the businesses and all that. Well, anyway, during Pioneer Picnic, they always have a dance. And of course, Pioneer Picnic back then was a little wilder than what it was now. You know, the cowboys and the loggers, you know, they always had to see who was going to be the toughest. Anyway, there was a guy on the payphone in the pavilion down there, and he was hollering because there was so much noise. And he made the remark that he was in this little hick town called Brownsville looking things over. Well, one of the drunken cowboys heard him call it a hick town, and of course, you know, that didn't set too good. So eventually what had happened was that the sheriff's office came over and escorted him out of the pavilion. Well, come to find out, it was Carl Reiner. Yes, they escorted him out of the building just so he wouldn't get thumped on. But then at the time, nobody knew who he was because he didn't look like he did on TV, you know.
I'm Myrna Bachman. I live south of Brownsville. When I heard that Stand By Me was going to be filmed here in Brownsville, I thought, that sounds like an interesting thing to do. So I interviewed and was selected to report for the extra position for the filming. And the life of an extra, I found quite quickly, was hurry up and wait. Although the first day I didn't have to wait very long because I was selected to be a stand-in for one of the special extras who was not to report until the following day. I was taken to the makeup trailer and makeup done. I was fitted with a blonde wig and a dress that was appropriate to the filming. And so I did the things I was asked to do during the morning, and then at noontime when we had our lunch, I was sitting eating with some of the other extras, and my husband, who'd been in another part of the park with some of the other family members, came over to ask me something. And it was quite interesting because he walked by me the first time not recognizing me, walked by me again not recognizing me, and when he came by the third time, I decided that I should make it known who I was, and he still laughs about that to this day.
Okay, I would follow up with my husband Bill. It was just kind of fun watching the filming and so forth, and seeing the reaction of the town people. I did have a chance to chat with the kids a couple times, but just informally, and I can't really recall anything about that except they seemed like really nice on the ball kids. My most fun adventure actually came afterwards, and it was, gosh, it was 1993, I believe, that we got a letter. I was volunteering at the museum, and a letter came from a young man in Holland who was interested in coming and filming Stand By Me filming locations. And somebody said, Joni, why don't you write back to him? So I did, and we ended up inviting him to stay at our house while he was here. So Roger Fletcher came over from Holland, and his task was to film locations of a film, and then they would show those on Dutch television, and people would guess what film it was. The winners would go in a pool, and someone's name would be drawn, and they'd get a trip or some prize. So he needed to find the locations, and he was with us, I think, for a couple of weeks. And we hooked him up with people in town, some of whom went one place or another with him. He didn't drive, so we found drivers, showed him the places around town. And the most fun I had was the very last day he was here. We went off to find the places that he hadn't seen and hadn't been able to find yet. And, before that, we also hooked him up with a friend from Brownsville who happened to work for Southern Pacific, and he was living in Mount Shasta and knew that the McLeod River overpass crossing bridge was the one that the boys ran across with the locomotive behind them. So we sent him up to Mount Shasta, and he stayed with that family and got to see that and film that. And then he came back to Brownsville, and we spent this last day looking for places. And we found the junkyard in Veneta. And the man who'd owned it didn't own it anymore, but he happened to be there. And so it was fun to talk to him. And then we went looking for where the body had been found. He hadn't found the swamp, and he hadn't found the place the body had been found, and he hadn't found where the deer crosses the railroad tracks. And so we got leads from, I can't remember how we found these things out, but we ended up going, I think it was along the coast, we went up towards Dexter Reservoir on Highway 58 and then turned back on the coast fork of the Willamette, and came to a farmyard, and there were some houses, and, you know, we were so lucky. We just kept bumping into people. Oh, yeah, I don't live here anymore, but I just happened to be here today, and I was here when they filmed this. And so one gentleman with a couple of kids took us tromping across a field into a grove of trees by the river, and there was this big hole dug with plastic in it. And the plastic was still there. That was the swamp. I didn't think, these are valuable actor kids. They're not going to put them in real mud with maybe some glass in it. So they had a nice clean swamp to play in. And we found that. And then we went up where the railroad track had been. They had apparently built a track through there. I guess they wanted it really quiet. So they had built a track on a flat piece of land. And it was neat. Roger had a little attachment to his video camera, and this was, you know, 14 years ago, so they weren't so sophisticated, and he had a little black and white film of Stand By Me, and so he would run that and stop frame it, and then we found the exact branch that was hanging over the railroad track, and the exact spot,
and he took that. And then we went back and also found the same place. The body was found by just two distinctive trees that were growing, I think, on the right side of the picture as the boys go down. I mean, it was so absolutely accurate. It was very much fun. So that was my fun time with Stand By Me, and I felt kind of close to it after that. I had written him, emailed him, when I knew the event was happening and said, you know, could you send us a copy of what you put on Dutch television? Well, Roger's kind of a workaholic and pretty particular about what he does, and so turns out that he's making a whole new production about his adventure in looking for the filming sites. So I think what he turns out is going to be very much fun to see.